What a run it was for PJ Fleck at Western Michigan. Four seasons culminating in a 13-1 mark, a berth in the Cotton Bowl last season, and was named the head coach of the Minnesota Golden Gophers on January the 6th. Takes over a really good team, one that won 9 games last year, its most since 2003, and just the second time they've won 9 since 1905. And they have 11 starters back from that group, including some big names. Rodney Smith, part of an excellent running back duo, Steven Richardson as well. They do need to replace the quarterback in Mitch Leiter, so that will be one of the questions heading into camp. And very pleased to be joined by the new head coach of the Golden Gophers, PJ Fleck. Coach, congratulations. Welcome to the Big Ten. You know, you think about your life and kind of your path. You started, you're a suburban Chicago kid, and so now here you are as a head coach of a Big Ten program back in your hometown, kind of your first really official duties as the head coach of Minnesota. How does it feel? What's this experience been like for you?
I'll be honest with you, as my wife Heather would say, welcome to your one day, and this is it. I mean, we're in Chicago, we're in my home city, and you're a head coach in the Big Ten. I'm just very honored to be a head coach in the Big Ten, to be honest with you, and all these amazing coaches, some of the best coaches in the entire world, and are in the Big Ten, one of the best conferences in the country, and it really is a dream come true, and now that's over, done with. Now we got to go to work.
Coach, I think you're in favor of the new recruiting rules. If I'm wrong, tell me. But
that's a heck of an assessment. You got that one right.
What do you like about them?
I just like that we can bring players up during the spring. I think the springtime in our Twin City area and the state of Minnesota is absolutely beautiful. And I think anytime you can gain an advantage somehow, some way, to change somebody else's perspective and not just have them listen to other people recruit against you. Hey, it's cold. It's this. Come up in the springtime. Come up in the, you know, when they come here in the summertime in camp and they start to see that. So anytime you can change somebody's perspective in the recruiting battles, you want to be able to do that. So I think that gives us an advantage.
You know, to have some old veteran players that are there, right? So sometimes when a new coach comes in, you have some attrition. How important is it when you can get those veteran guys to buy in immediately to what you want to do?
Well, that's the hardest part. You know, when I first took the job, I told them, I said, you guys did not pick me. I picked you. And anytime you take over in a new program and you bring a change of a culture, there's always the guys on one side who sit there and say, I'm out. There's no way I'm staying here. I'm too upset. I'm out. Then you have the guys that sit there and say, okay, well, I'm kind of on the fence. And then you have the guys say, I'm all in. This guy's perfect for me. Because I know I'm not for everybody. And that's okay. But my message to them was, look, if you don't want to be here, let me know. We're going to help you. I want your life to continue to be in an elite way and find what fits you and you can find the best mold. But if you want to be here, you know, we are going to do things at an elite level and we're going to do things just differently. It's not to do it on purpose. It's just we are who we are and you're going to see another different coach in another year. You know, this is the third straight year they've had a different head football coach, basically. And that's very hard on young people.
Describe what your offense and defense is going to look like for us.
Well, offensively, we're very multiple. We're an 11 personnel grouping, but we do a lot of different things with the inside zone, a lot of play action.
Explain what 11 personnel is.
Oh, one back, one tight end. I'm sorry. talking to a coach. You know,
a lot of people out there saying, oh, they use 11 players.
11 players.
That's innovative. Now I see why they hired this guy.
That's right. Yeah. Right, absolutely. But we, you know, Coach Sharaka, Kirk Sharaka has been a friend of mine for a very long time. I used to work for Coach Sharaka at Rutgers, one of the best offensive minds in the country. Did a tremendous job of turning around our offense from 1-11 to 13-0 at Western Michigan. And then defensively, we brought in Rob Smith. Rob Smith, he comes from kind of the Greg Schiano pipeline, and I loved how we played at Rutgers, and we were there attacking style defense, 4-3, but kind of based out of a 5-2. We have strength at linebacker, so we're kind of be a little bit more 3-4-ish, but looking like 4-3, if that makes a lot of sense to all the viewers at home. But I'm really proud of our guys. Really proud of the progress we made in the last 6 months.
Offensively, strong up front, offensive line, and the running back group, very strong. What do you see really playing out at the quarterback position?
Well, that's the biggest question. You know, I think Jimbo Fisher said it best at ACC Media Days. If you have a tough quarterback, you have a tough football team. We proved that at Western Michigan when we were 1-11, our quarterback was a first-year starter. He didn't have any failing, didn't have any experience. Then all of a sudden he goes 13-0, and he's experienced a ton. He failed enough to become incredibly successful. That's the hardest part because these guys don't have a lot of playing experience. They're, you know, Croft and Rota, they've really kind of separated themselves a little bit, but not a lot. But I'd like to make a decision here very soon in hopefully the first week or two in training camp so we can start getting most of those reps to the starter.
Reverend mentioned that they had won 9 games last year when he introduced you. When you took Western Michigan over, it was much different. So how is the the first few months at Minnesota different than the first few months at West Michigan?
Well, I think the biggest thing is last year has really nothing to do with this year's football team. You know, there's only 11 returning starters, if you want to call them starters, or guys that had significant playing time. We had 22 players from last year's off-season surgeries that still haven't been on the football field yet. We haven't even evaluated nor developed these players yet. So in training camp, we're going to be developing, we're going to be evaluating, and then we're going to do some type of mastery at some point. So that's the difficult part as you come in. But what we can reflect upon is we had a first year, year one, a first year, year two, a first year, year three, year four. Now we're able to do year one again. So what did we like? What didn't we like? Can we combine things in year two and three that fit in year one and make those adjustments?
You're going to have some really special facilities coming online soon. How will that change recruiting for you?
I'll tell you, our Athletes Village is absolutely elite. $166 million facility. I've been looking at it for 6 months out my windows. You've been there. You've been a chance to go through it with me. It's one of the most elite facilities in the country. And I mean by developing our student athletes at an elite level, academically, athletically, socially, and spiritually. It is all right there for our student athletes. Beautiful place.
To use your words, you're not for everybody. But you have some guys on your staff that have not been with you before, at least two. I don't know the exact number. How have they found your approach to the game?
Well, I'm not for everybody because I think a lot of people aren't for somebody, right? I mean, that's why you find your spouse and there's somebody out there for everybody, right? But with my staff, I brought a lot of guys with me, but the guys that I didn't necessarily have on my staff before, I've known through somebody that has known me. And so it's very hard for me to be able to hire guys that don't know my energy, my optimism, right, my positivity, because not everybody wants that and not everybody handles that in the right way. They think it's fake. They think it's phony. They don't think it's real. I'm just me, and I don't know what all those mean, because when you get a chance to be yourself every day, which Mark Coyle allows me to do and President Kaler allowed me to do, that's a blessing.
When you are instituting a new culture, and when the culture is as different as your culture is from the culture that was there previous, what has been the biggest challenge there in terms of, you've talked about kind of the buy-in and getting people to understand that, hey, this is the way it's going to be, and do you want to stay, do you not want to stay? But like, what's the part of it that you've kind of had to explain the most and try to get everyone to understand that this is how it's going to be and here's why?
Well, everybody wants change in our world until you get change, right? And then everybody has to change. But when you talk about the academic side, the athletic side, the social side, and spiritual side, we force you to make all of those four incredibly important in your life. And if those four attributes are not important to you, or there's two of the four, or three of the four, or one of the four, it's going to be very hard for you to be incredibly successful with us. We want you to value your life, all aspects of it, not just the football part. And a lot of our culture and our character building and our development, our Gopher talk, has nothing to do with the X's and O's or just the football aspect, but we believe in the better people create better results and they can play better. So we focus on that person. Not that we don't focus on the football part. That's incredibly important. But a lot of our culture has to do with building that man and building that young man into the people they say they want to become.
So how much of this change is about explaining the rationale behind the culture to people? In other words, if they're saying, well, yeah, you know, only two of those four are important to me right now, how much of it is trying to explain to them, well, here's why the other two should be important?
I think you hit it right on the head. The question why. Young people in today's world want to know why. Why are we doing this? Why do I have to do this? I think back when I was playing, that if a coach told you to do it, you did it. Why'd you do it? Well, the coach told me to do it. These days, it's a little bit different, right? My dad used to tell me the sunset in Sugar Grove, Illinois, right down the road. I literally believe that. Why? Because my dad told me that, right? These days, you say that, kids just Google it. Beep, 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 beep. Bull. That is not what it says on my phone. Mm-hmm. So you've got to be able to show why all the time. And I think that's really important, and that's how we've been able to run our culture.
I have a why question for you. Why the haircut?
Well, I lost a bet to my wife. That just proves that I'm usually never right within the household. Well, I can't tell you the bet. That's between her and I. We'll get to that part later on, I'm sure.
But she listened.
But I did listen, and she's been wanting me to do that for about a year and a half, and I had a peninsula going, and she's like, hey, before that thing becomes an island, shave that thing. And so we did.
Are you listening to him?
I am, yes. I am.
No, we got another analyst that should probably go that way. But I've got a quick one for you.
Yeah.
It's hard hitting. Any chance we could see the Oars on the uniforms in Minnesota?
This year, there's no way we're going to be able to implement those on there. Somehow, some way, maybe some stickers here or there. But we do have something coming in 2018 that we're working on with Nike. It's incredibly special, and it's a game changer in the apparel world.
Wow. That's something to look forward to. Hey, one last thing. I know this may be a real shock to you, but Jerry and Howard don't know the Minnesota Rouser. They don't know it. I thought maybe you could teach it to them.
You want to do the MIM?
I have no idea what you're talking
the
about.
The Rouser.
Okay.
Yeah.
That didn't make it any clearer than the first time you said it.
If I say it more emphatically.
N-N-E-S-O-T-A. Minnesota. Minnesota. Yeah. Gophers. How's that?
See, I got this.
Well, I would call that a cheer. What are you calling it?
It's the I call it the Rouser because that's what it's called.
It's called the Rouser.
Okay.
I had to learn that just as I said the same
thing. Did you ever hear a Rouser before you took your job?
No.
Okay.
You know,
that's okay.
Fight song, you know?
Okay. You listen.
Yeah.
Cheer.
That's good. Are you going to be able to do that?
No, I know. It's inappropriate for me to do it.
All right.
Then
cute.
I got to learn 13 other Rousers.
That was really good.
Because Franklin will hold you accountable. You better do that stage right over there.
All right, PJ, thanks a lot. Welcome again.
Appreciate it, guys. Roadboats, guys.